the virus hits the eastern seaboard of the United States first. Its host is a young hippo bought from black market dealers in Africa by the Central Park Zoo in New York for a new exhibit. The cargo handlers unloading the crated hippo are the first to become infected in North America, completely unaware of this deadly new zoonotic disease's ability to cross the border between animals and humans. The veterinarian, who's accompanied the hippo for the entire flight and been in close contact with the animal as it was prepared for shipping to New York, has already infected a half dozen passengers in the coach compartment of the passenger jet aircraft. Four of those passengers go on to connecting flights to Baltimore, Denver, Miami, and Los Angeles, and each of those passengers infects another four or five passengers on their respective flights, further spreading the disease. Before any symptoms have even begun to arise, the deadly virus has already been spread to the west coast of the United States and has made landfall in several prominent Asian cities. With an incubation period of 4 days, the first symptoms begin to appear but are so mild the victims shrug them off as seasonal flu or allergies. Within 2 days, though, the first carriers of the disease, the veterinarian and cargo haulers, have fallen seriously ill and require the use of ventilators. Authorities immediately realize that there's a serious problem, and as law enforcement investigates the victims' backgrounds, they make a horrifying conclusion. All three victims were involved in the transfer of exotic wildlife from Africa to the U.S. This means only one thing: a deadly and completely novel zoonotic disease has jumped from wildlife to human beings. Within a month, the disease is present in every U.S. state, even Alaska. Flights to and from the United States have long been canceled by every major nation in the world, but the lockdown has come far too slow. The disease is already present in Europe, the Middle East, Asia, and even made the return trip to Africa. This dangerous pathogen, which for thousands of years existed only in isolated pockets of animal life, has been unleashed on humans by the purchase of a single wild hippo. The disease has a death rate of 14%, making it one of the deadliest plagues since before the Industrial Revolution. The very young and the elderly are the worst affected, but as victims continue to mount, it becomes clear that even healthy adults are at risk of death. The federal government largely left the response to the virus up to the individual states, many of which were quick to enforce shelter-in-place laws and stay-at-home quarantines. As the disease spread faster and faster, though, self-isolation was turned into forced quarantine with martial law declared in nearly every U.S. state, and 2 weeks later a national quarantine enacted. The military is quickly called on to help enforce the quarantine. State governors take charge of their state's National Guard troops, using them to supplement law enforcement patrols designed to enforce the quarantine and get people off the streets. As martial law is declared, National Guard soldiers are granted police powers and begin to arrest quarantine violators. U.S. military police and infantry personnel are immediately dispatched to aid National Guard units in establishing checkpoints for necessary travel and patrols to enforce the home quarantine. Logistics personnel are dispatched to coordinate with the national industry and set up a network of home delivery for vital supplies such as food, water, and medicine. With the use of the Defense Production Act, the president has the power to force companies to prioritize the creation of vital domestic supplies and medical equipment. Despite most industries being shut down, industries vital to the national well-being are still operational. U.S. military personnel are used to supplement sick or at-risk individuals who cannot perform their duties all over the national commercial sector. U.S. combat troops are repurposed for helping to set up medical checkpoints and decontamination sites at vital industry workplaces such as oil refineries, mines, and medical equipment manufacturers. U.S. military personnel are then dispatched to assist overwhelmed hospitals, filling in for or supplementing doctors and nurses in the most hard-hit cities. The U.S. Navy's hospital ships, Comfort and Mercy, are dispatched to Los Angeles and New York, respectively, two of the hardest-hit cities. The Navy's fleet of maritime refueling and resupply vessels immediately go to work, supporting national industry and delivering critical food, water, and medical supplies across the eastern and western seaboard. The vast stockpile of vital supplies kept in reserve by the U.S. military in case of war is quickly tapped into and disseminated across major American cities, helping to curb food shortages. Overseas, U.S. military bases are placed on lockdown, with personnel not allowed to enter or leave the base except under very specific orders. Major American bases, such as those in Germany, Japan, Britain, and other nations, coordinate with local foreign governments to begin helping treat the country's ill, admitting them in medical convoys to their medical facilities, and helping ease the pressure on local hospitals. American medical personnel stationed overseas join forces with host nation doctors and specialists to work together and treat patients while limiting the spread of infection. American overseas combat troops work together with host nation military and police forces to help enforce quarantines and checkpoints, though are not granted law enforcement powers of arrest. As the outbreak continues, the U.S. Army's Mortuary Affairs, formerly known as the Graves Registration Service, takes on the grim task of assisting with the disposal of the dead. Still highly infectious, the dead can only be cremated in specialized facilities to prevent further spread of the disease. With more dead than available incinerators, though, Mortuary Affairs personnel coordinate with U.S. Army Corps of Engineers to identify and quarantine suitable corpse storage facilities, turning ice rinks and refrigerated trucks into makeshift morgues, a grim reality that will unfortunately continue until the virus is reasonably contained, allowing the military to take a back seat to normal civilian and government services and agencies. Ready to learn more about how dangerous diseases could affect us every day? Check out our video, Why New Coronavirus Could Be Deadlier Than SARS. Or maybe you're ready for a change of pace, then click on this other video instead. Either way, it helps to stay informed, so click now.